Irish, because my English is now better than my Chinese. So I was planning on talking about emergency medicine, the application process, and then a little bit about my side projects in aesthetic medicine and a little bit of private practice. But actually my colleagues have made my job very easy and have already talked about a lot of it, so I won't repeat things that have already been said. So I feel that when I tell people that I'm doing emergency medicine, people always say, you're crazy, you're so busy, why do you want to do it? So often convincing people to choose it as a specialty is half the battle. So hopefully I can give you a bit more information about emergency medicine as a specialty, the advantages versus the sort of disadvantages, and try to convince you that it's not so bad. So what is emergency medicine? Well, the emergency department in any hospital is the gatekeeper of the hospital. And in the UK, emergency medicine is a specialty in its own right. It's a very exciting specialty. We have to know a little bit about all the specialties that are around and be able to deal with any potential patient that walk in, any problem that walk in. So it's quite hard, and you know, it's not for everyone. So we initiate do the initial assessment, and we also go on to initiate the management of the unwell patient, and we have to stabilise them and kind of try to make a diagnosis and start some investigations and then decide which is the specialty that we should refer the patient to. So I think, I've never worked in China, but I've heard some fellow colleagues who have worked in China, and I think the emergency department in China is quite different, and it's very quick, and the doctors don't have a lot of time, just patients queuing outside the door, and they don't really have time to do any of this management stuff. So I think it seems to me that the emergency medicine doctor in China seems more like the triage nurse in the UK system. But over here we do a lot more, and we feel like proper doctors. So I mentioned this already. So it's a very important job to triage the patients accordingly. I think maybe in China, if someone comes in with chest pain, the ED doctor will just maybe call the cardiologist and say, this patient's got chest pain, and the cardiologist will come and see the patient. But actually the chest pain might be from a respiratory problem, or you know, maybe a surgical problem, and then they have to refer to the other specialties. So in the UK, it's the emergency doctor's job to make that diagnosis and then refer to the right specialty. And we also do a little bit more than just seeing them. Sometimes if we send patients home, we do organise outpatient follow-up. And in some A&Es, there's a review clinic where we bring people back for example, doing a CT KUB to look for kidney stones. They can come back the next day for that and will be reviewed, followed up by A&E. So I just want to talk a little bit about the patient journey through A&E, because I know not everyone's a doctor here, and I take this for granted, but I think a lot of people maybe don't quite know what the process is going through A&E. So if you were an unwell patient, if you were a child going to A&E, you would go straight to the, if that A&E has a pediatric A&E department, you would go straight there. You usually will see the pediatric triage nurse there, and then see the A&E doctor in the peds department on that day. Or you might be, if you're very unwell, you might be blue-lighted to A&E recess, and you go straight into recess, and you usually will be seen by a senior A&E doctor. If you just attend A&E, you will usually be seen by a triage nurse first, and the triage nurse then will decide whether you go to recess, majors, or minors. And then if you, in some A&E departments, they've got medical assistants who will then help you ECGs, take blood, you know, collect urine sample for you, and then when the ED doctor gets to see the patient, that major's patient, usually a lot of these investigation results have come back already, so it saves a lot of time. And minors are sort of things like minor injuries or minor fractures, or someone just has a temperature but is otherwise well. They get triaged to minors, and you may be seen by an ED doctor, or you may be seen by an emergency nurse practitioner. And those are specialist nurses that are trained to deal with kind of minor ailments and injuries. And from all of those, then a decision will be made, and then the patient is either referred, if they're unwell and need to stay in hospital, they're referred to an inpatient specialty. If they're not quite sure, well, if they're well, then they can go home. If they're not sure, they're in most AMEs, there's a CDU, which is a clinical decisions unit, where they are observed for a few hours, wait for blood tests, sometimes even stay overnight. And from there, then they can be referred to an inpatient specialty or be discharged home. So I want to think a little bit about pros and cons of working AME. I think that there are lots of, in my mind, there are lots of pros and lots of good things about working in AME. So every day is different, which is something that that excites me, because I'm interested in lots of things. But at the same time, that might be someone's con. So some people just like routine. If that's the case, then AME is not the best specialty for you. It is very fast-paced, high-pressure environment. You have to know lots of things. You have to think on your feet. You have to be very quick and talk to lots of different people. So that may not be someone's cup of tea, but I, on the other hand, you know, that's what makes it exciting. And you do get, you are exposed to all specialties. And maybe in the early stages of your training, if you're not sure which specialty is your is the one for you, it's quite a good place to start to just kind of find out a bit about everything. And it is a great experience, whichever specialty you go into in the future. It gives you a good foundation. So some people are bothered by the lack of continuity, but you can flip that and think, well, because there's no continuity issue, it's much easier to work part-time. And actually, since 2014, I've been working AME part-time, 60% initially, and then down to 50%. And I felt that on the days that I'm there, even though I'm only there half the time, on the days I'm there, I really appreciate it. Whereas I've known some surgical colleagues working part-time, and they're just treated like a part-timer. It's just not the same. So I think, you know, there are pros and cons about this lack of continuity. AME, yes, they do have lots of unsociable hours. People tend to go into AME after they come home from work or at the weekends. So evenings, night times, and weekends are the busiest time. But, and the AME rotas are not the nicest, and it's difficult to find to book the annual leave that you want. But when I was working at AE, I found it really useful to actually be free during the day to go to the post office to do my shopping. So, and you know, to take my children to school in the morning. So, I actually quite liked not having 9-to-5. It worked quite well with my lifestyle. And there are lots of locum opportunities. So, for those people who want to, you know, earn a bit of extra cash for whatever reason, or want to have some other hobbies that they really want to do and just need to fund that, AME is a great opportunity to do that. And it just gives you the flexibility that you don't have in most other specialties. So AME is very practical and hands-on, if you enjoy that kind of thing, then great. But if you're not, then this is not for you. And some of this has already been covered, so I won't go into too much detail. But basically, if you were a UK medical school graduate, you would just register with the GMC and you start the foundation years. If you go straight through, it takes 8 years from graduation to become an AME consultant. And of course, if you're an overseas doctor, then you need to pass your IELTS, your CLAB, and then register with the GMC, and then sort of start from the foundation year one or two level, and then carry on through this pathway. In terms of applications, there are different, you can enter at different levels. Currently I am doing, so ACCS stands for Acute Care Common STEM, and from ACCS you can do emergency medicine, intensive care, or anaesthetics, or acute medicine. So I'm doing ACCSEM. I'm currently CT2 now. But you don't have to enter from the beginning of ACCS. You can enter at higher training, or you can enter at CT3. There are lots of different ways to enter. So from CT1, you can now apply for, once you get your job, you can choose to have a run through. So once you get it, that's it, you're sorted until the end. So that one you apply after F2, and the national recruitment process opens in November. It's an online process, and the interviews are very much similar to the surgical structure. And you can choose to have run through or uncouple it, and then it's just CT1 to 3. So there's a couple of years ago they introduced this direct route entry into EM, where you enter and you've got experience from other specialties, related specialties, and you can just enter at SD3 level. They'll decide what experience you're lacking, and then they'll kind of customize your SD3 for you, where you just do those specialties that you're kind of lacking, and then progress to higher training. Or you can enter at higher training, SD4 to 6. So either you can complete an ACCS, or you've got enough experience, you can go straight into SD4 or 6. I won't go into too much detail. For anyone who has any specific questions, can contact me via WeChat later. And I think you've seen this slide earlier, but just to point out the ACCS, emergency medicine at the top. So the competition ratio, this is for CT1, is 2.21, which is about average. But then if we're looking at higher training, there's a huge shortage. So emergency medicine at ST4 level, there are lots of underfilled posts. So I think a really interesting thing about this is that because A&E is busy and it's very demanding, there's a very high burnout rate. And just want to kind of look at this quickly, but this is a serious problem in emergency medicine and a lot of the other specialties. So this is recent data from Medscape, and shows that EM has the highest rate of doctor feeling burnt out. It's at 60%. And a lot of the other specialties are kind of not far behind. How can we avoid it? This is a real issue. And if we're going to work until we're 68, we don't want to be burning out at age 40. So I think a really key thing to do to avoid burning out is to preempt it and to kind of diversify your skills and pick up other things on the side and know when to take a break. And I think I'm quite lucky because I trained in the UK and I'm still relatively young, and I can afford to take a couple of years out and then kind of go back into training. I know it gets difficult as you get older, but still taking a break is really important. And for me, sort of my exit plan from the NHS is doing aesthetics medicine. For the last 5 years, I've been doing aesthetics medicine alongside A&E. So currently I've applied for a career break from my A&E training, which has been signed off, and I'm doing aesthetics full time. So just for those of you who don't know what aesthetics is, it's Weijiangxing, Yimei. It's just procedures to help people kind of improve their appearance. And I do these procedures like chemical peels, microneedling, Botox and fillers, everyone know about, but also fat dissolving injections, and it's very interesting. It's something that requires a medical background, but kind of not related to medicine. It's about helping people in a different way. And now I also train in aesthetics as well with Harley Academy. So at the moment, it's still relatively unregulated in the UK and can be quite dangerous. So my aim is to help improve the standard and safety within the aesthetics field. And I think there should be a more defined pathway. At the moment, there isn't really. doing a course here, a course there, but I think it needs to be more defined. And I just have one quick slide on private practice, just to say that it is a growing market because of the increased burden on the NHS. A lot of people are turning to private healthcare. And so in theory, any doctor can set up a private practice. I found this quite shocking. I was speaking to MDU, Medical Defence Union, and they said, you don't have to be a consultant to go private. They'll insure anyone, pretty much. But usually most people who do go private are at a consultant level. most commonly GPs, cardiologists, dermatologists, but almost all specialties can potentially do private work, but those are the kind of the most common ones. And the, I guess when you, if you are thinking about going private, there's lots to think about. It's not that easy. You have to think about where you're going to practice, how you're going to get the patients in. Insurance is kind of the easy bit, but it does cost a lot more money. You've got to think about accounting and, you know, website, and if you're doing it on top of your NHS work, then it's, you end up with no life, basically. It's, and patients tend to be quite more demanding, and they can call you at all hours of the day. It's difficult to kind of get into if you don't have any contacts already in it. But it's something to think about, and it's a possibility. So just to sum up, if you really value variety and flexibility, and you have lots of interests, maybe you're only a little bit interested in medicine but want to do something outside, I think doing emergency medicine is a really good way to kind of to bring you some income and to feel like you're actually helping someone and have a very part-time career. And if you are not thinking about doing emergency medicine, then whatever you want to go into, this is a great experience. And for those who have just passed their lab exam, you know, maybe wanting to apply for medical training or surgical training, then just get a job in A&E. It'll be great. And then, yeah, just develop some hobbies and interests and keep an open mind to avoid burning out, whatever specialty you go into. And life's too short, so have some fun. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
没有时间了，
因为时间关系呢。
对，差不多了哈，独享了哈。
那今天的那个。